Matthew Ostrowski here with another episode of our exploration of the Dicy2 package for generative, interactive audio composition and interaction. So this time we're going to take a look at one of the most common use cases for Dicy, which is real-time audio interaction, using as our memory a segmented sound file and using a guided input, which is to say a sound source, which could be either live or pre-recorded, that is going to be used to send scenarios to our original memory. Before we go any further, I'd also like to mention that a lot of the heavy lifting inside the audio interaction patches we're going to be showing you today are based on the MuBu package, also developed at Ircam, which I highly recommend you check out if you want to really go in depth. These will work without any kind of profound knowledge, but if you really want to move on and take advantage of some of the possibilities, it's worth learning a thing or two about MuBu. There are some superb tutorials available on Ircam's YouTube page, and it's also worthwhile checking out the documentation within the MuBu package that you should have downloaded if you were reading the README, which you will need in order to use any of these patches we are looking at today. So the first thing I want to take a look at is just sort of our basic outline of how this works. What we'll be seeing today is a lot of tools that we have developed for you, most of which are Dicy2.easy_something. And we're going to be sort of looking at these in a bunch of detail as far as how they're all working. So you will be able to use these as a basis for your own further development, or just use them as they are for making a memory, analyzing an input, generating scenarios, and playing back audio. What we have here is the most basic sort of structure of how everything works, and I just want to talk through that before we start looking at the actual parts. Let's start off by initializing our server. We're also got a little subpatcher here that's automatically initializing our agent. You can see that's running happily. So step one involves creating a memory. And again, I'm not going to go into the gory details on this right now, but I'm just going to crank out a memory. Oh, let's turn on the DSP. That will help. And there we go. Send a bunch of learn messages to the Dicy agent. And this is all happens inside an abstraction called Easy Memory Maker. We will be exploring that in great detail shortly. And then we're going to take an audio output. This, by the way, is a guitar sample. And then we're going to take a saxophone playback here. And we're going to use the Easy Analyzer identifier in order to look at the incoming audio stream and label it with the same sets of labels that are generated by the Memory Maker. We're going to get label outputs from here. We're going to use the Scenario Maker, which we've already had a quick look at, to generate some scenarios. We're going to send that to the agent. The agent is then going to return sequences of events, and in this case, audio segments. And we're going to use another pre-made object called the Sequencer Renderer, which is specifically designed for playing back sequenced audio events. And then we're going to listen to it. So let's give it a go. So what we're listening to in the left channel is our guiding audio input. And here in the right channel are Dicy's responses coming out. So you can see lists of events are getting passed from the agent to the sequencer. Here we're finding labels. The scenario maker is making scenarios. And there we basically have it. And let us now take a look at all these stages one by one. The first thing we really need to take a look at is the memory maker. So this is a little abstraction we've made for you, which does three basic things. First, it takes a sound file in, and then it runs one analysis on the sound file, which is designed to divide it into segments. Then another analysis, which takes those segments and uses some sort of audio descriptors and to categorize each of those segments. It then takes that data from the various qualities of audio descriptors and does what's called a classification algorithm to create clusters of similar sounds, give all those similar clusters an identical label, and then we can send that to the agent or we can save it. So that's the sort of quick overview, and let's actually just walk through it here. So let's start by adding a sound file. Let's take a nice little bit of vocal material here. And the sound file has been put into the MuBu. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to run two kinds of analysis on it, as I said. First, we're going to figure out a way to segment it. The most common one is loudness. That's useful for most things. If you're dealing with material that's extremely legato or something like that, it can be a little problematic, but usually not a bad thing to start off with, is just working with loudness. And then we have a whole long list of descriptors that are available for us to use to analyze the sound with. Now, if what you're looking for to match in your incoming audio stream tends to be sort of pitch, timbre oriented, usually the best parameters to use are chroma. And maybe if you want to sort of push on the timbral aspect a little bit more, the harmonic spectral centroid is also useful. So you see here we can put one parameter in for segmentation, multiple parameters in for analysis if we want. And another thing about segmentation is your segmentation can vary a great deal. Cat visitation, pardon me. Hi, Clem. This is the world. Say hi, everybody. Okay. Is your segmentation parameters, we have a sort of default set of them that are sort of built in to the memory maker, but depending on the situation, you may have to tweak those a little bit, and we have a handy little window here. Advanced segmentation parameters, which will by which you can tweak that stuff as needed. If you need more information on exactly how those segmentation parameters work, you should look at the help file called pipo.onseg. I'll toss that up for you there now, which you'll find inside the MuBu documentation. So just to let you know, you've got some room on that, and you may need to iterate a couple times to make sure you actually get things, you get the kind of segmentation that seems to be appropriate for your file. So once we've decided on those two basic sets of parameters, the next question is one of what's called clustering. So if we have a set of descriptors for a sound file, what we're going to try to do using math is take segments that have similar descriptors or similar degrees of quality in their descriptors in multiple dimensions, because here we've got two dimensions. We've got chroma and the harmonic spectral centroid, and put them, sort of cluster them together in groups of similar values. And then each group that has a similar value, which in Dicy talk we call a class, is going to be given an identical label. So the same way in we saw before, everything with a MIDI note of 72 has the same label because they are similar in terms of pitch. Things with similar or close to similar sets of, in this case, chroma and harmonic spectral centroid parameters, we're also going to give the same label to. And this process happens here in the classification pane. And here comes another aspect of the work, which, again, may be iterative. You really have to do some exploration to see how well it works, which is how many classes do you use? And the number of classes is, there's sort of a trade-off. If you have a large number of classes, what's going to happen is each class is going to sound very similar because you're basically shrinking the number of the range of variation you can have within a single class. And on the plus side, that means your labels for that class will have a kind of clear articulation of, okay, we can hear that this thing is in this class and that thing is in that class. But what it also does is when you're sending a scenario to the agent, it means that there are fewer options for the agent to exercise. So you run the risk of sort of constraining yourself too much in terms of what's possible when you're actually sending scenarios to the agent. On the other hand, if you have too few classes, the classes aren't going to have enough individual character, and then everything just seems like a bunch of stuff going on that's, you know, and then it all starts sounding a little too random. So this is often the thing that you have to sort of experiment with iteratively to see what kind of results you get and what you like. Now, from experience, when you're working with chroma and harmonic spectral centroid, we have found that 30 classes usually works pretty okay. But again, your mileage may vary. So then what we can do is we can click on the Analyze and Cluster button, and you will see up here, now everything has been conveniently divided into segments. And we now have taken each one of these segments and given it a class label. And we can look at that here in the Inspect Classes pane. And this tells us a bunch of stuff. One thing it does is it gives us a list here of the class labels. See, there they are, 0 through 29, and the number of segments in each class, so we can see how even the distribution is. You can see it's also possible for a class to have zero elements in it. And this is basically just a visual histogram of that same information, just to give you some kind of sense of how many things there are. And you can see this is a relatively short file. This is about 23 megabytes. And you can fit, you know, as big as your memory will permit inside a memory. But so we don't have a lot of items per class. The most we have is about 5, I guess. And another useful thing we can do here is we can listen to the members of each class. And we can pick a class, either here or here, and then simply listen through. So that's the contents of class 1. Let's find one with a few more items in it. Let's look at class 22. So you can see how they're all, sounding more or less similar. So that's not too bad. Let's do one more. So it's pretty clear that we have a fair amount of articulation amongst our classes here. And one other tool that we have available here in the class inspector is the scatterplot view. And what this does is it'll give you a two-dimensional representation of some of the parameters of your classes. So in this particular case, the color of each of these points indicates the label number of the class. The size indicates duration. And here, just to give us some sense of how things stand relative to each other, we have loudness on the x-axis and the harmonic spectral centroid on the y-axis, but there are a bunch of menus, so you can pick your things like that as you need to give you a sort of more visual sense of what the relationship is between all the various parameters in your memory. And now that we've done that, we can use the dump message to send that information off to our agent using the built-in send-receive bus based on the name of the agent. You can also save your memory, and this kind of audio memory actually lives on three separate documents. The first document would be your original sound file, usually WAV or AIF. Your second is a MuBu file, and the MuBu file contains the segmenting data and the analysis data. Let's just quickly, actually, I'm going to pop back here. Let's look at this MuBu. If we look at this, let's look at this segmenting data in matrix view so we can see what's actually being stored in there. So what we have is we have one row for each segment, and then we've got the duration of the segment. We've got some loudness data, which was used for the segmentation. And there's our harmonic spectral centroid and chroma, which is actually a bunch of different things. A chroma has 12 values. And there's the label that's been assigned to it. So all that data gets stored in your MuBu. The third document is in the form of a .json dictionary file. And what that is storing is the data that is actually used to analyze and label the audio. So your clustering algorithm lives inside there. And so every memory has three documents associated with it. MuBu.MuBu.JSON.AIFF or WAV. And the best thing to do is really just give all of them the same name, simply with a different extension. So if I click on write here, and you'll get the name of the original WAV or .AIFF file, and you can simply hit save. And what that will do is create automatically your dictionary file that's got your clustering information in there and your MuBu file, which holds all that other information we were discussing a moment ago. So now that we've done that, we have dumped the data to the agent. Let's see what we get. We just do the usual, send a generate message to the agent. It's going to return us a bunch of segments, which are basically lines on that MuBu. And
there you go.
And it all works. Next, we're going to have a look at, this is all fine for manual usage, but we need to have a look at how do we take real-time input and use the same analysis and clustering information that we've used in the memory to generate labels from incoming audio data. And that happens mostly through the magic of this, which is the easy analyzer identifier. And here's an important thing that I probably should have mentioned about four times already, but I don't remember, frankly, if I have or not, is that when you are working with this particular set of easy objects, and something you'll be finding yourself if you're working with a bunch of MuBu-based stuff, is that all these modules, the easy loader that we have here, which just loads files for us, the easy analyzer identifier, the easy sequencer renderer, all these have to share an argument. And you can see they all do here. This has the argument identify. If we opened up the original here, you would see it was a pound one. This also has the argument identify. This also has the argument identify, because all of these modules are sharing data from that MuBu, from the dict, and from the buffer. So they all need to have a common name in order that that data can be shared. So just keep that in mind whenever you're working on these kinds of patches, that they all need the same argument, which, by the way, should not be the same argument as the argument of the agent. Agent needs its own argument. So that said, best thing to do is we start off by loading a file into the easy loader. This is pretty straightforward, load message, and the file name of the audio file. The audio file is sort of used as the key for this. So once you send it the audio file name, Dicy will look up and find in Max's search path a .mubu and a .json with the same name. And then all of those will be automatically loaded. And if you use the load message or the wave, it will also automatically dump the data to the agent. Also, you will notice that here in our analyzer identifier, it's already selected for us both our segmentation parameter and our analysis parameters. And this is because this dictionary is linked to the analyzer identifier, so it automatically knows what parameters it needs to analyze incoming audio from. So the analyzer identifier isn't so complicated. The first sort of important thing is a noise gate. So we simply analyze what we want to be analyzing and not background whatever, which is obviously particularly important in live situations. And the other sort of important thing we need to know about is the timing modes. Because as audio data is coming in, we have to figure out how often are we going to do an analysis, classify it, come up with a label, and send that label to the scenario maker. And there are three built-in approaches into the analyzer identifier. The first is CHOP, which simply sends at regular intervals. In this case, it's 250 milliseconds. It'll simply divide everything into 250 millisecond chunks and pass them out. Now, this is good for data that is fairly legato, where your changes are sort of in a constant state of flux. But it does produce a lot of data, because every quarter of a second here, you're getting a new label, which may or may not be super relevant to the overall audio picture. The other two modes use the segmentation. And again, you can also tweak the segmentation parameters the same way you could in the memory maker with the advanced parameters here. And the two different ways of doing it are what's called event mode. And what that does is it finds the beginning of a segment, and when it reaches the end of the segment, well, the beginning of the next segment, if you want to be pedantic, it looks at that segment, runs the analysis on it, labels it and hands out the label. So it's taking into account the full spectral or pitch or whatever qualities of the event you're analyzing, but it is always going to be sort of one event behind, because you aren't going to get the data sent out, obviously, until the event is completed. So it's more accurate sort of sonically, but you do wind up with something of a temporal delay when you're working with that. And again, this is all neither here nor there, your choice. And the third one is instant mode. And what instant mode does is when it identifies the beginning of a new segment, it looks at a window. In this particular case, it's an 80 millisecond window, and tries to guess based on that first initial window size what the analysis is likely to be for the rest of the event, the segment. And obviously this is going to work a lot better with an organ than it's going to work with a piano, because obviously a piano attack is very different from what you get with the rest of the piano. So again, all these things are sort of trade-offs, and you have to play around with it and see which one is the most appropriate for you. So once you've got those things set, there's not much else to do except play some sound. What's going to happen is it's going to pass out a label number. The label gets sent to the scenario maker. Scenario maker generates a scenario. The agent comes up with a response sequence to the scenario. And last but not least, it goes to another abstraction called the Easy Sequencer Renderer. And I guess we might as well talk about that now as any other time. The Sequencer Renderer is a device for playback that is particularly designed to work with this particular set of things. It's based on a MuBu object called MuBu.concat, tilde. And we've got just a few of the playback parameters available to MuBu Concat, but we've also got a little sequencing thing going here. It has two modes, internal and external. When you're playing something in internal mode, as soon as one segment is finished, it will then immediately start playing the next sequence, the next segment in the sequence. And external mode, which will use some kind of external information, some sort of bang coming into the right-hand outlet of the sequencer renderer in order to trigger events. So you can have a completely separate timing mechanism, because remember, the agent's putting out a list, right? So you can iterate through that list either using the timing of the segments themselves or from some other timing source of your choice. So those are your two basic options there. These parameters essentially determine the fade in and fade out time of an entire sequence that is sent to the sequencer renderer. So in this case, we have a four-item response. So it's going for those four items, it's going to fade in over this time and fade out over that time. Down here in the renderer section, we've exposed some of the playback options available in MuBu Concat, and MuBu Concat can do tons of things. So again, check out the help file if you want to see what else it'll do. The segment crossfade, pretty straightforward. It's simply doing our fade ins and outs of each individual segment as it's played. Resampling is your transposition and sense. Resampling variation is how much it's going to, each individual segment is going to transpose within the maximum range set by the resampling. And reverse will, of course, play your samples backwards. So let's just quickly close that up and start this file. And see see what we get. And you can see we got the threshold going here. We're below the gate right now. So there's a quick little bit of that. An important thing to keep in mind when you're putting these things together is, especially in a situation like this where we're using chop as our parameter, we're sending a lot of labels to the scenario maker. And one of the parameters available in the scenario maker, which I just put here in a handy little sub window, is what's called chance, which is the percentage chance of a label generating a scenario. Because when you're constantly sending labels, very often, or almost inevitably, if your scenario is of any significant length, your scenario is not going to finish playing before it's got a new label coming in and stepping on it. So very often you'll want to sort of keep that down. And all of these parameters are going to, in some way or another, be tweaking your playback and changing the flavor of the messages that are getting sent to the agent. And we'll look at that in a little more detail in our performance tutorial, which will be coming up. So that's the basic order of business we got going on over here with the analyzer identifier. So finally, we're just going to take a quick look at the sort of full flow of everything here. And what have we got here? First of all, make sure our agent is initialized. And then we're going to load a file, which I've actually already loaded. And here's a new object. And this is mostly just for reference and to give you some kind of visual feedback as to what's happening in your performance setup, called the Easy Memory Explorer. It's going to show you the file. The cursor is going to jump around to show you the segment that is currently being played. And if you need it, it also has a class inspector and a scatter plot to keep you up to date. And we should all be familiar with these objects by now. Here is our easy loader. Again, same argument as the analyzer identifier and the sequencer renderer. The scenario maker, by the way, does not need an argument because it's not sharing any of the MuBu or dict data. Now that we've loaded that up, let's give this a whack. And I'm just going to quickly show you what happens if we use external mode on our sequencer renderer. Let's play this some more. Go to external mode. I'm even going to stop the playback here. And now we can, using an external source or our next button here, we can now cycle through this last response to the scenario with any kind of timing mechanism or any kind of sequencing that you care to invent for yourself. I think that's about it for today. I hope this has clarified some things about how the audio workflow and audio interactions operate in Dicy2. Thanks very much for your attention, and we'll see you next time.